Okay, so Dan, I told you this is the Paul Campbell Literary Society. I told everybody about you. We were just discussing unfair files, and I told our group that you're really not going to talk about unfair files because you read it a while ago, it wasn't memorable, it didn't work very much.
I did re-look at my reviews. I do vaguely remember a number of things. I don't remember you had said there was some point that one of your members had made that I made that. But I don't remember the individual points because I think I posted it in 07, but I think I read it in 05 because I usually have a number of reviews that I do and keep, just until I decide to post them. But, if you want to ask, general questions about books in general, I can answer that. And I do remember, it's not a good show, so, but...
Well, we feel the same way about books. What's the key? You're going to talk to Dan. I guess the big question was, as I mentioned to you before, our group was wondering how it wanted to answer. We just didn't think that the writing was that good. And I know you had told me some things about that. If you could explain that to the group again.
Well, it's basically the same thing as in any... think about the Oscars. How many times have you seen a movie or an actor or an actress win the best Oscar for acting or film? Like any other award system, it's generally, politics. In writing, you have to go back to the end of World War II. That's when NFA writing programs started. The most famous one is the University of Iowa Workshop. And basically, people got the ideas in universities, professors, that somehow anyone could be a writer, that you could teach people to write. Generally, I think it originally started out as mostly journalism, but then people thought, well, we could teach poetry, we could teach prose, and box it down, put things in an A to B to C kind of way to teach, and then anyone could pick up a pen or hang at a typewriter and become anything. It's patent nonsense, because if you think about it, most human endeavors, you can't teach most people to be anything. I could take voice lessons from now until Tuesday, and I'm never going to be going to the Metropolitan Opera and being a singer. But think about that, you could take anyone off the street and try to teach them to write is ridiculous. Because look nowadays with emails. Putting aside even people writing emailees with the various little doodads and stuff people use in email. Most people cannot even if you were to ask them, what did you do today? Most people would write a very broken thing. I woke up, I did this, and then they would forget things. And most people don't have a flow, a narrative sense in life. But to be able to teach people this, it's kind of silly. But nonetheless, universities thought, well, this is a good way that we can make money. And over the years, I've been in the last one of writing groups. I've met many people who got to NFA writing programs. And pretty much all of them that I've met are disappointed because, you pay however many thousands of dollars to take a course, and then you come out and you realize, well, I'm not Hemingway, or I'm not Emily Dickinson, or I'm not, whatever writer inspired them to want to be a writer. Nonetheless, as NFA courses got started, it became a self-fulfilling prophecy that more people went into these groups, more people paid money, and therefore, eventually you'd have thousands and then tens of thousands of people with masters in fine arts, these NFA writing mill firms. They call them writing mills because they're sort of like puppy mills. They turn out a whole excess of product, meaning people who think that they can write, and there's no...
Up to, because we're back up. You're Barry.
Yeah.
You're gone. I'm very interested to hear about your time.
You want to hear about what?
I would like to know five favorite novels. Five top novels that come to mind if somebody asks you that question?
I'm just looking because as far as novels, I don't know if I could say five top novels. I can tell you for your book, books that I can recommend.
I'm very much interested in what you like. So you tell me five books you enjoy reading and that you would like to read again and again.
Okay. I don't know if I can say like. I'll tell you the things that I think are great books. I would say Moby Dick is a book that everyone should read in their lifetime because Moby Dick by Herman Melville is probably it's his best book. As I mentioned to you, it's not really about this crazy old guy who takes his crew to their death trying to chase after this whale. It's basically it's one of the first books that's sort of existential in that it's. It wasn't just about a certain A to B to C plot. It's about basically why do people do certain things that they do? Why do they do things that are self-destructive? Why do they go and do these things that don't serve them? Keeping with American books, I would say another one obviously is Huckleberry Finn, Besides all the nonsense about whether the word nigger is good or bad, I mean, the way it's used, it's about this young man coming to grips with his society and his place in the world. Another one, A Tree Grows in Brooklyn, your group has already read, and that's a good example of a book that if people ask you what it's about, you realize that it's about everything, but it's not really about the little girl growing up. It's about that place and that time and that family. And another American novel, I'd say The Grapes of Wrath by John Steinbeck is in his book. And that's also a book that, yes, ostensibly it's about a family of Okies that move out to California and try to make their way during the Great Depression. But it's really, again, just like A Tree Grows in Brooklyn. It's about a certain place and a time. And let's see, if I think of a fifth novel, Native Son by Richard Wright is also a good book. I'm sorry, someone said none of the books have been in the last 80 years.
None of those books have been written in the last 50 years.
Yeah, well, I mean, that goes to show you. I would say, I try to think of books in the last 30 or so years. I'm hard-pressed. I mean, I can't think of a major name writer in the last 30 years that's been published, at least, that I would say 50 or 100 years from now, anyone's going to really be arguing with great. William Kennedy, yeah. William Kennedy is a good example. If I were to say the best published writer in America right now, in terms of at least still being alive, even though he's very old, I would say read William Kennedy's books. Starting with the first major book that he published as a novel Legs, which is a book about Lex Diamond, the gangster during Prohibition. Then he did Billy Fallon's Greatest Game, which was an interesting book. And then his most famous book is Ironweed. And that's a book that actually did win the National Book Award. It won the Pulitzer. And that actually deserved it. So, Charles Johnson is another one. Charles Johnson has written two or three great books. Probably his best book, and if you want to read a really great book, Oxford and Pale, which is a story about a runaway slave being chased by a slave catcher. And that's I think Johnson was first published in the early 70s and Kennedy in the late 60s.
What was that last thing for me?
Oxherding. O-S-H-E-R-D-I-N-G. Oxherding. Like herding an ox. Oxherding.
Whether you're in magazine or anything about what's going on culturally and in the lot of methods here.
I'm sorry, I can't hear really. Who's closest to the TV? Maybe they could be the one.
She said, who do you think the best the human condition today? Who would be somebody current that you would enjoy today?
I would say William Kennedy if we're talking novels, because I did once meet William Kennedy at a book reading that he did when I was living in Minneapolis. I told him that one of the reasons I thought he was a great writer, and I think this was when he had written a novel in the mid-90s called Quinn's Book. I think that was, he was on a tour for that. But he had, I told him, he writes that he has balls. One of the things that's wrong with a lot of current NFA writing is that, I think I might have mentioned to you the difference between masculine and feminine writing. William Kennedy writes very masculine. By that, I don't mean that he's dick-waiting on every page. It's not like Ernest Hemingway that has to tell you that he has testicles every third page.
Yes.
But when I say masculine, I mean that the writer takes control, and he shows you, here, this is the world. This is the way people acted. These people in this situation, and this is what they did, and this is why they did it, and this is how they did it, and we're not going to look away. Too often when you get a good contrast would be someone like William Kennedy versus Rousseau. One of the things when I experience art, and I remember it, the things that come back to me are not necessarily the details, but it's how it impacted me. I remember the feeling that I got when I read something. When I read Richard Rousseau's book, it was sort of like that old Seinfeld episode where George goes into the pool and he has the shrinky little penis. When you read Richard Rousseau, you sort of feel like you're getting smaller and smaller, and it's a bad soap opera. You know exactly how everything's going to turn out, but we don't ever want to token. If Richard Rousseau and William Kennedy were to write about a specific situation, let's say they're writing about a bad marriage that's falling apart because the wife miscarried the child of the husband, and this has caused tension in the marriage, and the couple is no longer as emotionally intimate. If William Kennedy were to write about that scenario, you would be getting distinct scenes written sort of unflinchingly, almost the way a surgeon might dissect something and put something on the table, like he was performing an autopsy. And he wouldn't look away. So Richard Rousseau, on the other hand, would fall in a lot of banalities. There would be a lot of swelling music in the back, and it would be a bad soap opera. That's not to say that someone can't write poetically in the sense that, or metaphorically about something, but the difference is the way of it. Someone like William Kennedy assumes that the reader is fairly intelligent, that the reader is not going to flinch, that the reader is not a baby. Bad writers have to tell you everything. Bad writers, you know, have to explain that, okay, my character is going to the bathroom. They're going to take a shit. They're going to take 3 squares of toilet paper each time they wipe their ass and tell you why and explain the importance of ass wiping. A great writer is going to assume that you know that and is going to say, well, here's my character sitting on the toilet, but he's thinking back about what happened when he was a young man and he heard that Pearl Harbor was bombed and he realized he had to be drafted. a great writer or a great artist is going to put you in the mind of the character. And he's not going to be necessarily thinking about the situation. To get back to something like Moby Dick, a great writer like Melville is going to, he's going to give you details in Moby Dick. Anyone in your group, if you've ever read Moby Dick, you know there are chapters that talk about the whaling industry. That's just to give you some background and give you some of the terminology that later on in the book you can reference things. But Melville isn't really just doing that to give you the background. He's also giving you that kind of information so that you can move beyond it. Yes, to ground you. You know, if I was to write a book, or any writer was going to write a book, a great writer write a book about something that isn't well known, say something is set in a candle factory, the making of candles might be used as a way to give you a little background to where the character's coming from, but also to use it as a metaphor, because the whaling chapters in Moby Dick also not only give you a background of where Ahab and Ishmael and those characters come from, but it's also giving you information so that you're using the same metaphors. When as the book goes on, the metaphors about whaling, the metaphors about harpooning, the metaphors about the different racial makeup of the crew, it becomes a common language. A bad writer isn't even going to be operating on that level. A bad writer let's say Richard Russo tried to write Moby Dick, he would probably go into the background of maybe that Captain Ahab as a little boy had been abused by his peg-leg uncle, and that can be used as fodder for any kind of art. It's something that tries to reduce something to the lowest common denominator, and it tries to go for an emotional response first. Great writers, you know, assume that you have emotions, and that if I portray a scene of a woman getting raped, that you're going to react a certain way. You don't have to have that musical swell. That's one of the difference between any great artist in any field. And if you look at Shakespeare versus lesser artists that were writing at the time, if you look at the greatest plays of Shakespeare, I'll give you an example. Shakespeare was a great writer, but if anyone has seen the plays of, say, Ibsen or Shaw or Eugene O'Neill, one of the differences is between modernism and pre-modern writing, especially in drama or novels, is that modernists put situations that people could relate to. You know, if you've ever seen Arthur Miller's Death of a Salesman, you know, he made a great play about this small little man that has this menial job, that has this secret, and it comes down to it. In Shakespeare's time, it was basically assumed that only kings, only great people, only the cream of the crust of society could experience these feelings. And modernism, you know, in a sense, did away with that, and it democratized the idea that anyone could feel things. I mean, Captain Ahab, for example, was the captain of a ship in Moby Dick. But it's a small little ship at the bottom rungs of society. Whaling was, I think it might even be said in Moby Dick that, you know, whaling were people who worked on whaling ships were considered below slaves in a sense, because it was like one of the least, least appreciated jobs. But anyway, I'm talking too much here. I hope that answers your question.
I have a couple of questions here that people are trying to get me up with. Remember, I remember was asked about Kevin Bartlett, and I remember the other day when I thought you were looking for the book that I sent you, and you came across and asked me if he was a journalist, I think, but you're not familiar with Fears of the Earth, is that correct?
Yeah, the name, you know, rings a bell, but I've not read him that I can recall.
Of course. Okay, so when you were talking about the scene of every day a woman has somebody sitting on the toilet, somebody used the example like the movie, like the horror movie Psycho, where the shower scene would not show anything. A good writer, how would be that spirit, just describing things in with the rent roads without being so little.
Well, yeah, that's a good example of a dramatic scene that's rendered quite well. Because in Psycho, you never actually see a knife penetrating a body. It's in black and white, so you only see what appears to be blood going down. Oftentimes, a good dramatic device that a writer will use, instead of, let's say if you're writing a scene, let me think if there's a book that I can think of. To use A Tree Grows in Brooklyn, for example, if you read that book, you remember there's a scene where Francie runs into the pervert. There's a pervert going around in the neighborhood. It's in the second half of the book. And she seemingly runs, and I don't remember how it's exactly played out. In a modern book, for example, I never read the book, but my wife did. There's a book, what's that terrible book called Lovely Bones? Compare a book like The Lovely Bones to A Tree Grows in Brooklyn. And A Tree Grows in Brooklyn, and I'm not arguing for censorship, but I want to show you why something works. When Francie is confronted by this pervert, who's probably the equivalent of the village rapist in the book, we don't see a dramatic scene where Francie is pulled down, her skirt is pulled down, and the pervert starts fingering her. We're allowed to get the scene and get the sense of her horror, and I forget how the scene actually plays out. She's not really molested. She's just scared. But it's a much more dramatic scene than a scene where, I think in that book, I think Jessica had me read just that one second one time, where the character, the girl was raped, and then she tries to go back into the body of someone to have sex with another girl's boyfriend or something. First off, in the great book, the greatly written Betty Smith book, you get a scene that's realistic. Now, I'm not saying that we couldn't do something where you have a spirit occupy a body or whatnot, but notice how that goes for the lowest common denominator, that someone has been murdered, someone is trying to re-experience life, but in doing so, they have to go for the most trite moment, that she wants to have sex with someone's boyfriend. But think about it in real life. When you think, if anyone in your group has been in extremis, let's say you've been in a hospital and you're having a surgery that could result in your death, or you're having an illness, the things people generally think of are not these melodramatic soap operatic moments. I don't think about a teenager, I would, but at the age of 46, I don't think about the first girl that I kissed. These little things. The things that come to my mind are these little moments, your life when it flashes before your eyes as you're dying. You simply think about maybe the smell of your Aunt Susie's pies cooling on an autumn evening when you're 7. You might think about a story that a neighbor came over one Christmas and told a story about when he was a boy having Christmas. You think about these little moments. And a great writer will find those kinds of little moments and open them up so that you get a common experience. Most people are not going to be able to relate to a teenage girl wanting to go into someone's body and have sex with them, especially when it's poorly presented and it's poorly written and everything is expected. And anyone who isn't even a writer could basically think about that scene to begin with. So that's one of the differences. People, if they're reading the scene of Francie and the pervert, can put themselves in that little girl's shoes. Most people couldn't put themselves in the shoes of the character who wants to have sex with the boyfriend in The Lovely Bones. And so getting to those moments of commonality is one of the things that separates great artists. You know, I had shown you, if you have a browser up, this is a good segue. I showed you yesterday when we talked Christina's World, the painting, by Andrew Wyeth. If you bring up a browser and you show that painting, I explained for people.
I'm not going to bring it up on the laptop.
If anyone, Stanley Kubrick films when not emotional. But I would disagree wholeheartedly. He doesn't go for cheap emotion. But the scene where how the computer is losing his mind and regresses to an infantile state, to me was very sad, because that character, even in just the maybe 10 minutes worth of speaking time that he gets in the film, is literate. The character had, you're put in the seat of this entity that isn't even really human. But you can relate to the things that the character is feeling as it's dying. And so that's for me what defines great art. And in the last 10, 15 years, I'd be hard pressed to think of books like that. But again, I tend to go off on digression, so I hope that answered your question.
Yes, Christina's world.
Oh, you got it. Okay. So if you look at Christina's world here, you bring up a picture like this, and I just want to explain a couple of things why something like this is a great painting. Now, I'm assuming that most of the people in your group have probably been to, like, museums where you see modern art, right?
Right.
Right. So you know most things like abstract expressionism or modern art, you'll see someone like Mark Rothko, for example, painted these huge canvases that were usually one or two colors, orange. Or you'd have the drip paintings of Jackson Pollock. But if you take a look at this painting, human beings think narratively. We cannot help but think A to B to C to D, because we live linearly in time. So things happen along an axis of time. If you look at this painting draws you in for a number of reasons. First of all, you see this girl who's lying what looks on a hillside or a farmland. You look at her, and this was painted in the 1940s, but so, you look at her arms or you look at her legs, and it looks like she's chilled. If this were a modern painting, you would think that she might have anorexia. But probably she might be someone suffering from polio, she might be someone who's ill. And the painting is called Christina's World. And if you look at where she's ostensibly looking, she's looking at this farmhouse off in the upper right-hand corner. So the painting, this is her world. This is, she's looking at that farmhouse the way Dorothy is thinking about going back to Kansas in The Wizard of Oz. There's something about that farmhouse that is direct there. And we as a viewer can see exactly what her great, what you'd call a desideratum is, the thing that she greatly desired. We're put in her shoes by being looking behind her, but we're also sort of in the position of a godlike position of understanding her, because we're also behind her. You don't see her eyes. She could actually be looking at the building in the center if she's looking askew, but we have to assume that she's looking towards the house. And then if you also look in the direction that she's looking, there's a fence that looks like what looks like to be tires, the tires of a tractor. There's also in the sky, it looks like maybe there's a bird flying between the two houses. There's something in the sky, it looks like that. So this puts us in her position, and we have a dilemma. We can draft a narrative. Why is the girl on the hill? Why does she look ill? Why does she look like she's crawling as if she just came out of the Sahara after a week? Why is she looking at the farmhouse? Is this farmhouse where she grew up? Is this farmhouse where there's water or food that she needs to eat? What is that little thing in the sky? What time of the year is it? Are the tire tractor marks somehow significant? So there are all of these things that we can imbue into the painting. And what's driving the girl is going to be slightly different than what you're thinking. But we can all put ourselves in her position. Now, if you were to divide the painting into quarters, if you were to put a vertical axis halfway through the painting and then halfway down through the painting, and if you look at the bottom right quadrant where you can only see the grass, that alone, if that was the whole painting, that could be an abstract expressionist painting. It's not much different than something that someone like Pollock or Rothko or these abstract expressionist painters could do. but there's no narrative there. If you look at the bottom quadrant of this painting, the only narrative that...
Hold on just a minute, because I'm going to go a lot of the same. Show them which part of the painting we're looking at.
Yeah. Imagine the painting divided into quarters, and then look at the bottom right corner.
So that would be like you're just doing an abstract thing.
Right. Imagine. Right.
Okay.
Something into that, I could say, well, this is the grass at Dachau, you know, or something, or the outside of Dachau during World War II. But these are things that the picture doesn't give you. The artist would not be giving you this. This is something you could imbue. I talked about how someone like William Kennedy, a great artist or writer, will give you their world. Someone like Kennedy will impose his vision on you. Wyatt here, if Wyatt only painted that bottom right quadrant, that's basically just tossing something out and saying, well, you make of it what you will. Well, that's not really art, because art is communication. Art is telling you something about the world. An artist is telling you, this is what's important to me, whether it's the dilemma of the girl on this hillside, whether it's Captain Ahab and his crew going after Moby Dick around the world. The artist is telling you, this is important to me. If you look at the whole painting, Wyatt is giving you the narrative of the girl. He's giving you just enough narrative that you can legitimately imbue something into it. Again, why is the girl important? Why is the girl on the hill in the first place? Why is the girl thin? Why isn't she walking? Why is she seemingly cold? And these are things that anyone can put themselves into the shoes of the girl and say, I understand the dilemma she's going through. Now, it could be that the girl just tripped. If this were a film, rather than the painting, you could say, well, 5 seconds ago, the girl was standing, and maybe she tripped, and maybe she sprained her ankle, and she can't walk. Maybe she's not ill. Maybe she's just very thin. Maybe she's looking at the house, not because she grew up there, and if she's trying to remember that, maybe that's where the doctor in the village that's close and lives to her, and she was out for a walk. You can put yourself Wyatt basically is giving you a situation that anyone can relate to. But if you look at just the bottom right quadrant, there's really no situation. There are great paintings, for example, that don't have human figures in them. But again, you can relate to the situation. There's a great painting of Niagara Falls by a Hudson River School painter called Frederick Edwin Church that you just see before the water falls off the cliff. You see the foaming of the water, and you can actually almost sense the life in the water as it's churning to go to fall over the falls. So you are put right in a moment, probably 4 or 5 seconds before the water is going to descend hundreds of feet. That's a great painting because there's drama there. It's well wrought. And that's another thing, too. If you look at just the bottom right quadrant, anyone could paint that. You know, I could go to a canvas, take a roller of paint, and I could paint the whole canvas off. There's no skill involved. But there's clearly a skill involved here in white, because if you look at the girl, for example, if you look at the hands even of the girl on the hill, you can almost see her fingers of say her left hand, and you can almost see how they're crooked, that she's actually in the act of almost clutching at the grass. And the more detail you look, you can get more narrative. The girl is almost clutching at the grass. You can see, for example, on the right side of her face, her hair seems to be blowing up a little bit, so maybe there's a breeze. You can see these little details that are seemingly throwaway, but when you add them up, you get a sense of narrative, you get a place, and you're put into a dramatic situation that we can relate to. And that's one of the things that great art does do.
So, Dan, what would you suggest that we're going to go over 10 years, but at 37 years, what would you suggest to broaden our minds or what we should be doing?
Any of those novels that I mentioned, I would read. Let me give you a few other books. I mentioned a few great novels. Let me give you a few books that are not novels, since you read nonfiction too.
Okay.
If you want to read a great autobiography, there's an out of print book called All the Strange Hours by a writer called Lauren Isley. He was not a fiction writer. He was a naturalist and an essayist. He lived from 1907 to 1977. It's probably the greatest published autobiography that I've ever read. And I say that because the writing is great. It's poetic. It gives explanations of this man's life. But at the end of the book, you don't really know a lot of intimate details. In the whole book, for example, you learn that he's married. He mentions his wife once or twice. You get nothing about the marriage. But each chapter in the book gives you these moments of observation. Say he's out on a dinosaur dig in one. Or you get an episode where he's riding the rails during the Great Depression with hobos. And each of those gives you these little snapshots of life as he lived it. And it's just a wonderful evocation of the 20th century. It's really greatly written. It's poetic. And there are going to be a lot of those moments that even though you may never have ridden on the rails with hobos, you can relate to what he is experiencing with these men. And you can get the book on Amazon. It's out of print, but you can get the book on Amazon for a few dollars.
What? French books.
Yes, okay. I'm talking. You can put it from. My wife also mentioned a couple of novels. There's a writer called Evan S. Connell. He's got two books that are really great, Mr. Bridge and Mrs. Bridge. There was a film made called Mr. and Mrs. Bridge with Paul Newman about 20 years ago, and it's a pretty good film, but the books are much better. What really sets those books apart is the chapters are very short. I think the longest chapter is maybe only two or three pages. A lot of the chapters are only half a page. But again, both of those books have these little moments in the lives of this married couple over a 20-year period with their children that are just remarkable. For example, I still remember there's one chapter, I think it's in Mrs. Bridge, that's only about three-quarters of a page long, and it's about her daughter, Mrs. Bridge's daughter, I think, hiding in her closet as Mrs. Bridge is looking into a mirror, remembering something about her youth. And so you put it, and that's a great example. It's only about three-quarters of a page long, the whole chapter. But the daughter is eavesdropping on an intimate moment of her mother remembering her youth. Who can't relate to that kind of experience? How many of you women in the group have ever looked at, say, your husband shaving, or looked in a room and seen your daughter or your son reading a comic book or reading some favorite book, and